Hi, I'm Dr. Hector Garcia. I'm a researcher, an author, and a clinical psychologist specializing in PTSD, primarily among combat veterans. Views expressed here are, of course, my own. I'm also a strong proponent of evolutionary psychology for its explanatory power and indeed its potential to improve the human condition. But I also happen to live in a nation in which a large segment of the population denies the very premise of evolution by natural selection. I want to tell you that this is a big mistake. In denying evolution, we forego the evolutionary sciences and all the critical lessons that they can teach us about ourselves. Let's discuss one of them. It concerns my day job as a PTSD specialist. First, although I'm going to be talking a lot about combat-related PTSD, we can develop PTSD in response to a wide variety of traumatic experiences, such as child abuse, spousal abuse, assault, rape, a motor vehicle accident, or even a natural disaster. In my practice, I provide what are called evidence-based psychotherapies. What are these? Medications go through research trials to determine whether or not they're efficacious at treating a given medical condition. Similar trials have been conducted for non-medication treatments. In the case of PTSD, we have over 40 years of intensive research looking into what works and what doesn't. And we've ended up with two highly effective treatments. One is called prolonged exposure therapy, and another, cognitive processing therapy. Ask for these psychotherapies by name because most people no longer meet full criteria for PTSD after having completed one of these two treatments. This is the good news because PTSD can be an emotionally painful, life-altering psychiatric condition. And science has brought us treatments that can give PTSD sufferers new lives. But a treatment is only as good as one's ability to access it. Unfortunately, stigma about mental health persists across the world and limits access to care. And while clearly experienced among both sexes, stigma can be amplified among men for reasons I plan to expand upon in a later episode. But across the globe, boys are socialized differently around emotions and help seeking, with messages like boys don't cry or boys shouldn't be afraid. And in the military settings, there are high expectations to suppress emotions and to ignore personal discomfort. So these messages get solidified. So, man or woman, if these were the early messages you received, then you join the military, see combat, and develop problems, it's not hard to imagine how you might see having PTSD, much less seeking treatment for it, as a weakness or a personal failure. This narrative of failure is often echoed unwittingly by the medical community. Psychiatry is grounded in the disease model. The model emphasizes the concept of disease entities, the idea that something is malfunctioning. Even though this concept is necessary for rendering diagnoses, for delivering treatment, and for disease prevention, it overlooks the fact that certain psychiatric conditions exist today because they were useful adaptations in our ancestral past. As one example, base rates of snake phobias are unusually high, far disproportionate to the real dangers of the modern world, such as driving, even in places where the probability of encountering a venomous snake is practically nil. Fearing snakes in our ancestral past, when we encountered them far more often, had clear adaptive value. It helped prevent our ancestors from getting envenomed. In short, the threat of snakes has been present long enough to shape our evolved fears, whereas the threat of getting killed in, say, a motor vehicle accident has not. Similar advantages have been proposed for PTSD. Consider the fact that we, as Homo sapiens, have spent most of our history living as hunter-gatherers in far more dangerous circumstances than we do today. Notably, our ancestral environments were swarming with dangerous predators, and getting killed by a rival group of humans was far more likely than in most environments of the modern day. Because of our recency living in the modern industrialized world, we still possess many of the cognitive and emotional calibrations for that far more dangerous ancestral world. In a sense, PTSD reflects a reactivation of those calibrations. Let's now review PTSD symptoms and discuss their potential adaptive value as an alternative to the narrative of failing. PTSD symptoms tend to fall into four clusters. We'll discuss the symptoms within these clusters, one cluster at a time. The first symptom cluster is negative alterations of our thought processes. Those with PTSD tend to have overly negative thoughts about things like safety, the ability to trust others, and the need to control one's environment. While not especially adaptive in times of peace, in times when environments are dangerous, being worried about danger, being mistrustful of those outside your immediate circle, or trying to control as much as possible can mean the difference between life and death. In our evolutionary past, when mortal danger could present itself at any moment, having negative thought patterns helped our ancestors avoid death or injury. Now on to the second symptom cluster, re-experiencing symptoms. This is just as it sounds. PTSD sufferers re-experience their traumas in different ways, such as intrusive memories, nightmares, or seeing something in their environment that brings it back. But this is not like a normal memory. The adrenaline goes up, the emotions are intense and raw as if the experience just happened yesterday, even the way it may have happened 50 years ago. While these symptoms are highly disturbing for the experiencer, from a survival perspective, it makes perfect sense that dangerous experiences would replay in one's mind to ensure that they are never forgotten and to reinforce caution. And indeed, with some exceptions, dangerous experiences tend to be remembered with greater clarity. The third symptom cluster we'll discuss is hyperarousal. Let's discuss three symptoms within this cluster. Symptom number one, hypervigilance. Hypervigilance means being more vigilant than one needs to be in a given environment. If I'm in a war zone, I've got my head on a swivel. I'm watching everything around me, just as I would if I was walking around the danger-filled savannas of our ancestral past. But these are not examples of hypervigilance. They are examples of normal vigilance given the environment. What is not normal is doing this behavior at a grocery store, at a restaurant, or a family function. So what do I mean? If I'm hypervigilant at a restaurant, I've got my back to the wall so I can watch everybody come in and out. I'm sizing people up. I don't like that guy. I got to watch that guy. I'm running tactical scenarios in my head. If that guy tries this, I'll do this. If that guy tries that, I'll do this other thing. Paying attention to routes of egress. How can I get out of here if something bad happens? Again, adaptive for dangerous environments such as combat or our ancestral savannas where you had to either watch everything or be eaten by a predator, but not adaptive in peacetime. One reason we train people to keep preparedness low in most everyday situations is that when we're watching everything, we're not enjoying our lives. We're not really present with our family and friends, focusing on the meal, the conversation, or the precious time that we spend together. Symptom number two, irritability and anger. Another problem with hypervigilance is that it tends to maintain irritability and anger. By looking around, we maintain high levels of stress hormones such as adrenaline, and that tends to give us what we can think of as a low ceiling. In other words, if I'm walking around at an 8 all the time because I'm on patrol, so to speak, something small happens and I go to a 10 very easily and I lose my cool. Now, getting angry very easily is adaptive in a combat environment or in our ancestral past. If somebody fires on you, you lay down return fire immediately, full on to the death. Anger facilitates this. If a wild animal charges and you can't run away, you have to turn to fight to survive. Anger facilitates this. But anger in a safe environment that puts strain on family and friends can cause legal problems and is just not socially adaptive. Symptom number three, sleep problems. With adrenaline coursing through my veins during the day, it's hard to sleep at night. Now in combat, or in a world filled with nocturnal predators, or tribes conducting nighttime raids, you don't want to sleep too deeply. But as anyone who has ever suffered from insomnia knows, not sleeping is a problem. The final symptom cluster is avoidance. It makes perfect sense that avoiding something dangerous can be adaptive, especially after a trauma. If the last time I walked past a certain cave, a giant cave bear rushed out and nearly ate me, I want to avoid that cave in the future. However, avoidance prevents recovery from PTSD. And this concerns the fight or flight response, which is a survival mechanism that all animals have, including humans. If we perceive danger, even if there is none, our system gears up to either fight the danger or run for our lives. Adrenaline gets released, our heart rate increases, we breathe more heavily, we sweat more, all of which we need when fighting an enemy or running away from a predator. But we don't need this in a crowded restaurant. However, with PTSD, the fight or flight response often gets activated in places like restaurants. So what happens is that I walk into a restaurant, fight or flight kicks in, and I go way up here. But I'm not fighting an enemy because, well, I'm at a restaurant. So I'm not burning any of this energy off. I'm just stewing in it. And this feels very uncomfortable. So what do? I leave. I leave, the adrenaline goes down, and I feel better. However, when I avoid, my nervous system never gets used to that environment. The way that the fight or flight curve works is that it goes up very fast and it goes down very slowly. And this is because those of our ancestors who responded to danger very slowly and recovered very quickly, more often than not, got weeded from the gene pool. So we inherited a nervous system that works this way. The problem is that most people with PTSD leave way before the response comes down. And what's happening when it's coming down is the nervous system is learning. It says to itself, I've been here all this time at this restaurant. Nothing terrible has happened to me. Nothing has tried to harm me. This place must be safe. And it starts to turn off the fight or flight response to save energy for a real emergency. If you stay long enough, the next time the curve is a little lower. The next time after that, a little lower still. Until the end, you can go to restaurants and feel comfortable, focus on your family, and just enjoy life. But that can't happen if you leave. So one of the treatments, prolonged exposure therapy, helps people systematically stay in certain environments until the nervous system is recalibrated. For more information on exposure and cognitive therapy, I'll provide a link to my TED Talks on this topic. But once again, the important thing to know is we have treatments that are highly effective. Still, people report feeling that accessing treatment is a sign of weakness or a failure, or that they should be able to suck it up and handle their problems on their own. These perspectives often prevent people from accessing life-altering treatment, sometimes for decades. But the symptoms underlying PTSD are not failures. They are ancient critical survival mechanisms that kept our ancestors alive, that are actually responsible for us being here today, but that just didn't turn off when they're supposed to without proper training. And that training is evidence-based psychotherapy, which helps these ancient survival responses adapt to the here and now, to normal peacetime environments. In my clinical work, I have found immense value in sharing the evolutionary basis for PTSD. The resulting insight can be profound. I have found that most people who have survived a trauma are especially receptive to the idea of a brain designed for survival, perhaps even more so than those whose survival has not been challenged in the same way. Many feel less broken when they understand that, in a way, PTSD is the brain doing what it was designed to do, but in a different time and circumstance. Evolutionary and clinical psychologies are similar in many ways. One is that all psychology is evolutionary because all psychology comes from minds formed by natural selection. Another is that both operate largely below the level of conscious awareness. But maybe a more important similarity is in their shared utility. Both can reveal to us our unhealthy behaviors, both can offer corrections, and both can be used to diminish human suffering. Evolutionary sciences can provide us with incredible insights into so many aspects of humanity, from our dating lives, to why nations become divided, to why we go to war. Here, we've learned that they can also help take what we see as personal failures and reframe them as naturally occurring survival adaptations that can be recalibrated when they no longer serve us, allowing us to have greater compassion for ourselves. Thanks for watching. I've been Dr. Hector Garcia. You can find my books on Amazon and Audible. Links are in the description. You can reach me at hector-garcia.com. If you enjoyed what you watched today and want to hear more of me, be sure and like and subscribe.